So I'll begin by finishing something that I wanted to do last lecture, but I ran out of time, which is to discuss the parity problem. So last time we were talking about how to use equidistribution estimates. Mostly on primes. Okay. And how to use this to prove results like bounded gaps between primes. Okay, so we now have a quite well understood sieve theoretic mechanism, mostly based on the Solberg sieve, for converting estimates on primes in arithmetic regressions to bounded gaps between primes. So what I mean by equidistribution estimates on primes is that you consider sums like this. You take, say, all n between x and 2x. You restrict to an arithmetic regression. And you sum, for example, maybe a shifted version of a mangled function, or maybe the prime counting function instead. Or we also need to count just the trivial function 1. And for some of the more advanced sieve theory type stuff, we also have to consider Dirichlet convolutions of various functions alpha and beta. So just remember the Dirichlet convolution. It's defined like this. So various functions here, the key thing they have in common is that they all depend basically on the prime factorization of n plus hi, right? So these are all functions basically of the prime factorization. And you sum them in some arithmetic regression in some range, say between x and 2x. For all these expressions, there's expected to be a main term in this expression, something like maybe x times some function typically just of the modulus. Plus an error term, okay, which will depend on A and D. Yeah, okay, so maybe, okay. Okay, and by an equidistribution estimate on these functions, what we mean is we have some bound on this error term, maybe on average. Okay, so there's various types of input that you could put on these bounds, but you assume some upper bounds. Maybe on average, in some sense. So you have all these bounds, and then you start taking linear combinations of these bounds. The whole art of sieve theory is to choose very cleverly chosen linear combinations of these sieve axioms. At some point, you insert the completely trivial fact that if you have a sequence of positive numbers, then the sum is positive as well. Okay. But basically, if you take linear combinations and you just keep using trivial non-negativity, then if you're lucky and you chose your sieves very optimally, you can eventually get results such as there exists n between x and 2x such that n plus, say, for example, at least 2. Well, you can do at most, but nowadays you can also do at least. That's the.
I didn't see what you were writing behind the
button. Oh, okay.
Take it back with yourself.
Okay. Right. So I mean, you can use sieve theory to count all kinds of things, but one of the things you can do you can prove bounded gaps by using the sieve axioms and some clever linear combination of them and positivity to show that you can find at least one n in here such that two of the shifts of n are prime, and this will give you bounded gaps between primes. Okay, so I sketched how this argument worked last time. So one can hope that maybe you could use this to prove other things. So maybe you could prove So we saw last time that if you assume the best possible equidistribution estimates, the generalized Elliott-Halberstam conjecture, then you can get the bounded gap between primes to be at most 6. You can improve this even further. So 2 is the optimal, but maybe just be slightly less ambitious. And just shoot for 4. Right? Can we use sieve theory to at least show that you can find a pair of primes of distance 4 apart or less? And unfortunately, the answer is no. So a long time ago, I forgot exactly when, 80s or so, Solberg pointed out this parity obstruction, which prevents, well, it certainly prevents proving the twin pound conjecture from sieve theoretic means, but it also prevents proving a bound of four. And I wanted to explain why. You see, basically, sieve theory is, this n parameter is nothing sort of interesting happens to n when you do sieve theory. You just take linear combinations of these axioms, but you never mess with the n sum. And so everything here is linear in n. And because it's linear in n, you can replace the summation over n with a weighted sum over n, and everything still works. So if you had a sieve theoretic argument that took equidistribution estimates and non-negativity and produced gaps of size m was 4, then the same argument must also hold with weights. So given any non-negative weight function, if there was a weight which had exactly the same equidistribution estimates as the unweighted sum, so if you can find a weight for which you have the same main term and error terms with basically the same upper bounds, maybe you have a slightly worse constant or something, but if you have the same upper bounds, the same error term with a weight, of course, weighted sums, as long as you're non-negative, you also have the trivial non-negativity. If a sequence is non-negative, then the weighted sum is also non-negative. And so if you just inspect how sieve theory arguments work, if you could prove this sort of estimate by sieve theory, then you could also prove the same estimate with a weight, which means, in particular, that you should also be able to prove not only can you find an n for which you got a gap of length 4, but that n must also be in the support of your weight. Okay, so if you can prove a gap of 4 by sieve theory, then you can also prove it with this weight. And this unfortunately leads to a conjectural contradiction, because I can cook up a weight for which you have, well, we believe we have all the same equidistribution estimates for the weighted sum as for the unweighted sum, but for which there is no number n in the support of the weight for which you have this conclusion. Okay, so this is a sort of indirect proof by contradiction argument. You have to get your head around it a little bit. So if you could prove H1 less than 4 by sieve theory, then you could also prove a weighted version, but the weighted version is false, at least we believe it's false, because we can take the following counterexample of weight. So if you take the following weight, I think I need one. Is this the one I want? Hang on. That's the opposite one. No, that one will work. No, hang on. Wait. Okay, actually.
Not in my sort of sense.
Yeah, I don't want to do things quite this way. Let's say it's a bit of a mess. I didn't quite do things to set things up properly. See, I want these to have the opposite sign, so I want that to be minus. Okay. If n is equal to 2 mod 3. Okay, actually, yes. I just realized I didn't set this up properly when I prepared my data. So this is worse than. Okay, so it's supposed to be really simple, and now it's not going to look for simple, unfortunately. But there's a stupid obstruction mod 3 that I have to deal with. What I need to do is I need to pick. I think I did not set this up properly, but if you pick a weight something like this, this may not be exactly right. But if you pick a weight like this, where lambda is the Liouville function, so lambda is minus 1 to the number of prime factors of n counting multiplicity, So this is basically the Mobius function, but it's still non-zero for non-square free numbers. And in particular, it squares to one always. So this weight, what it does, at least, so let's say if n is 2 mod 3, and it doesn't matter what it is, n is 0 mod 3. This weight, if you if n is 2 mod 3, it's only non-zero when n and n plus 2 have the opposite parity of number of prime factors, and n plus 2 and n plus 6 also have the opposite. Okay, there's some choice of signs for which one I'm going to say works. And you want n plus 2 to have the opposite parity, and n plus 2 and n plus 6 also have the opposite parity, which means that n and n plus 2 can't both be prime, and n plus 2 and n plus 6 can't both be prime. Although n and n plus 6, these guys, this pair can both be prime, but these pairs can't. And similarly over here. And so the way this weight function is designed to be set up is that if you pick any n in the support of this weight, then you can't have any n plus 2 and plus 4, any two of them prime. You can only have a gap of 6, but not 2 or 4, if I set things up properly. But this weight, we believe to have the same equidistribution properties as the unweighted function 1, because if you expand out this weight, this is 1 minus lambda of n, lambda of n plus 2, minus lambda of n plus 2, lambda 6, and then because lambda squared is 1, plus lambda of n plus 6, when n is 2 mod 3, and something similar when n is 1 mod 3. And so you see, this weight is equal to 1 plus a linear combination of functions which involve two factors of lambda. And when you stick that in, for example, if you stick in a weight like lambda of n, lambda n plus 2, so maybe these two guys combine, maybe for example, if this is 2, you'll get two terms, one of which involves the prime factorization of n plus 2, and the other involves the Liouville function of n. And we have this heuristic called the Mobius randomness heuristic, or in this case, I guess, the Liouville randomness heuristic, that this function, the lambda of n, fluctuates so randomly, it should basically exhibit a lot of cancellation with any expression that doesn't involve the prime factorization of n, but instead, for example, involves the prime factorization of n plus 2. So it's not a very precise heuristic, it's not a theorem, but we believe that any expression which involves both, say, Liouville of n and something of n plus 2, involving the prime factorization of n plus 2 and maybe n plus 4, n plus 6, that should have lots and lots of cancellation. And so that should all just get absorbed into the error term. In fact, we even believe, if you're ambitious, some sort of square root type cancellation, it should be much better than the error terms that we ever play with. And so these extra terms should just be noise in the error term. And so whatever equidistribution estimates we can hope to prove for the weight 1 should also be true, at least conjecturally, for this weight. And then therefore any sift theoretic argument would also give a gap of length 4 with this weight. But this weight is designed so that there are no gaps of length 4 in the support of this weight. Unfortunately, I kind of butchered this argument, but this is Silberg explained it a lot better than I did. But
it should be called not parity problem, so parity confusion.
Sorry. Okay. But that's my fault. Okay. All right. But you can make this argument a little bit clearer. And it does tell you that there is no sift theoretic way to purely use sift theory to beat 6. You can do better if you don't use just sift theory. You use something else. In particular, if you don't just have a sum over n, but if you break it up, if you can do something non-trivial with the n summation, like split it up into a bilinear sum. And maybe, Henrik, I don't know if you're going to talk about that. But. Sorry?
There will be quite an overlapping what I'm going to say next time.
Okay.
Okay. Unfortunately, none of these methods will get you the twin prime conjecture, but something else is needed. All right. Okay, so that's the parity confusion, I guess. Okay, so now I want to talk about how we prove equidistribution estimates on primes. So, for example, how never mind the shift. Let's just look at. Okay. So we have some prime numbers in arithmetic regressions. Maybe subtract off the main term, which you can write. So we have this sort of discrepancy of the prime numbers in arithmetic regression minus their expected term, the average, and you want to bound this sort of expression. Okay, so let me just write this as sum over n, lambda of n, f of n, where f is just, so it's just the indicator function of n between x and 2x. N is a mod d minus one of a few d. Okay, so it's basically a weighted sum of this arithmetic function, this function that depends only on the prime factorization of n, and this very explicit non-arithmetic function, which just depends on this congruence class and on the size of x, size of n. Okay, so one can ask a more general question. How can you control sums? Yeah, so it's an extremely general question. Okay, how can you control sums of this form where one function is arithmetic, it depends on the prime factorization of n, and the other one is non-arithmetic, it just depends on sort of local factors of n, local properties of n. Or maybe it could be like an exponential phase, maybe a character, these sort of things. Okay, and how would you control sums like this in general? Okay, so standard answer is to read chapter 13 of Ivan Yachinkovsky. This is closely related to sums over primes. Okay, how do you sum a non-arithmetic function over primes? It's almost exactly the same sort of question. And so we have a lot of techniques for doing these things. Of course, we always have the crude triangle inequality thing that you can always do. Cure all the cancellation and get a bound. And this will always give you some bound, I guess if n is finally supported. But it's never usually the bound we want. Usually we want to save like a big power of the logarithm over the trivial bound. But this is the benchmark, it's the trivial bound. Yeah, so we usually have trivial bounds here. In this case, usually something like x times a polylog in x, and you want to gain an arbitrary power of logarithm generally over the trivial bound. Okay, so there's a variety of techniques that one can use. You can decompose f into split f into other terms into good pieces. Okay, and a very common technique is Fourier summation. Fourier expansion. So, for example, this particular function f, you can split either by multiplicative Fourier analysis into multiplicative Fourier expansion over the non-principal characters with period Q. I think I had that right. Period D. Okay. Or you can do an additive Fourier expansion, which, if I am not mistaken, is something like the. It's more complicated than this. Maybe if D is prime, it's like this. Okay, there are other terms or something. If correction terms, if D is not prime. But roughly speaking, it sort of depends on whether you can, actually, maybe I still need to enforce this to be co-prime. There is some sort of Fourier expansion that you can do. It's roughly like this. In the additive character, because ED, of course, is the additive character. Okay, and so you can split f into pieces, and so like you can split something like this into lots of pieces, maybe of this form, or maybe this form, and then you just use the triangle inequality, and you start staring at something like this. Okay, so you can take this expression, break it up into characters, multiplicative or additive, and estimate each of them separately. Usually you can't exploit cancellation any further. So you just give that up with the triangle inequality and you estimate these things instead. So this unfortunately loses, of course the triangle inequality can be very lossy. This step can be quite inefficient if you have a lot of terms in your expansion. If your original expression is not very close to being a character, then you have a lot of terms here and you lose a lot with this step, but often you still have to do this because there's a lot of gain that you can get once you have some sort of character structure over here that you want to save. Okay, so this is one thing you can do. You can also split alpha into pieces, and we'll see how that works later. There's that. If you split things in such a way that everything's multiplicative, if f is multiplicative, Okay, then you can try to use multiplicative number theory. Okay, so if you are staring, for example, you know, at a sum like this, okay, having an extra character, then multiplicative number theory steps in, and you can start trying to estimate this in terms of the L function, well, not the L function yet, but the Dirichlet series. Okay, and this has some formula. This is this this has some expression in terms of. So it's an L function, and then you can use either classical complex analysis methods, or nowadays you can also use pretentious methods to start controlling this expression in terms of what you know about the L function. Okay, so this is one thing you can do if you have a multiplicative character, but unfortunately, because our understanding of this denominator is not as good as we'd like, this tends to only work well when your multiplicative function character has a very small conductor like polylog, unconditionally, or if you assume GRH or something, you can do better, but only if you have assume some strong conjecture. Okay, so you have this, but it only works for multiplicative characters of rather small conductor. What else can you do? If you have not just one function f, but lots of functions f, and you only care about what happens on the average, then the large sieve inequality is your friend. Okay, so if you are actually looking at a family of these sums, then for each single function f, maybe all you can do is a trivial bound. But if you have a whole family of these these fi's, and these guys behave in some sense orthogonally to each other, then very often you can get a really good bound on the square sum. You know, there'll be some natural bound on a square sum, which means that you beat the trivial bound on average for most of these fi's, as long as you have some good orthogonality here. Okay, so I won't. I'll just assert that you can do things like this. Of course, So that doesn't help you if you only have one f. It only helps if you have many f. So a lot of the game is to somehow disperse a bound from one f to a bound on many f. Okay, so that's another thing you can do. What other tricks do we have available? Right. Yeah. So another thing is that if you can. If you can decompose your original arithmetic function, so it depends on the prime factorization. So typically, it would have some factorization into a Dirichlet series, that maybe you can factorize it as a Dirichlet combination, a convolution of two other functions, or sometimes maybe a combination of some finite number of Dirichlet convolutions. That if you have a factorization here which exploits the arithmetic structure, then this linear sum now becomes a bilinear sum. Running out of letters, okay. Okay, so if you have a Dirichlet convolution structure, then you can split up a linear sum into a bilinear sum. And then there's a lot more games you can play with a bilinear sum than you can with a linear sum. So, for instance, if this is multiplicative, if you're trying to sum against a multiplicative character, then things are really nicely factor. Okay, so you get a product structure, which is very nice. So that's sort of so that's one thing that can happen. At the opposite extreme, if you don't have a multiplicative structure, if you have instead additive structure, if for example this happens to be a linear phase, for example, then it's not multiplicative. But then you can often exploit cancellation just in this bilinear kernel, even if you don't know very much about these weights. Okay, and then so which is so. Yeah, so we have one final tool which is utterly trivial but incredibly important, which is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Okay, so the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality is a way in which cross-correlations, like correlations between, say, a beta and something else, can be controlled by self-correlations. Right? So, you know, that's what the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality does. Okay. Okay. And this is great because self-correlations are often a lot easier to understand than cross-correlations. So if you have a sum like this, okay, then what you can do is that you can split it. And often there's so in more advanced applications, you don't have a double sum, you may have a triple sum or something. And there's lots of ways in which you can split and do Cauchy-Schwarz. And knowing where to cut the sum and do Cauchy-Schwarz is half the game. If you want really good equidistribution estimates, there's a whole art of where to cut. But just let's not worry about that right now. If you have this sort of sum, then and you want to bound this, then you can take the beta out here. Okay, and if you do Cauchy-Schwarz, okay, you can split this into yeah. So by the way, everything I'm saying is completely standard. As I said, this is all in chapter 13 of Ivan Nishkovsky. But okay, so if you have this sum, you can split it by Cauchy-Schwarz. Okay, and the point here is that beta shows up here and these gamma show up here, but you split them up, okay, that you no longer have a joint sum involving beta and gamma. Okay, now this is non-negative. This you just bound by some trivial bound. Okay, once you're non-negative, there's no cancellation to exploit, so trivial bounds tend to be pretty sharp. And then over here, so this you have to expand out, okay, and so. What you typically do is that you expand out and you get a two L's and L prime, and then we have something like gamma of L prime. Okay, typically it's good to move the M over here. And then something like F of ML prime. Bah. Okay, and so you have an expression like this. And then it's common to split up this into cases. So there's the diagonal term, L equals L prime. And then there's the off-diagonal terms. Okay, and you usually treat these differently. In many applications, actually, there's a continuum. It's not just equal or not equal. You can split up depending on how many prime factors L and L prime like have in common, or how many prime factors divide L minus L prime or something. Okay, but roughly speaking, as a first approximation, you have a diagonal term and a non-diagonal term. With the diagonal term, there's no cancellation here because this is now positive. For this, you pretty much are forced to use trivial estimates. Which aren't very good, but on the other hand, the diagonal is pretty small usually. You know, if L is being summed over some range, let's say L to L, the diagonal is only a portion one over L of the whole sum. So as long as your L is non-trivial, if this sum is summing over some non-trivial range, the diagonal contribution should still be better than the trivial bound. And the bigger the L, the smaller the diagonal contribution will be. And then conversely, you have the off-diagonal terms. And here what you can do, you can do further Cauchy-Schwarz sometimes, but often at this point, you can just get a lot of mileage, actually, out of just taking the triangle inequality, bounding this by something trivial, and then estimating by something like this. And the point here is that all these unknown arithmetic functions like beta and gamma are gone. Okay, this is a function purely of sort of very smooth functions, f. And this is as a function f, maybe a character, or something that you understand very well. And if you understand in particular exponential sum estimates, okay, in various ranges. Okay, maybe emphasize incomplete exponential sum estimates. Okay. Then if you have good bounds on here that exhibit lots of cancellation, then you can get some non-trivial gain here. Okay, now of course you lose something. Okay, so you're giving up some cancellation, some potential cancellation because of just using the triangle inequality. So if L is very big, then this may be inefficient. So you've got these two cases. This case, the diagonal case is better when L is big, but worse when L is small. And the off-diagonal case is the reverse. It's actually worse when L is big and better when L is small. And so there's a whole art of picking your where to Cauchy-Schwarz so that you try to balance these two terms to be about the same size. But I don't want to talk too much about that. That's sort of technical. Okay, so this is the basic strategy. More more, well, this is the simplest model. Okay, and often you have other parameters to average over, and so you often don't just want exponential sums, what do you want, control one exponential sum, but maybe an average of exponential sums, which often leads to multi-dimensional exponential sum estimates. So to get the best results to exploit the most cancellation, you often need to control exponential sums on the average. And this requires often quite high-powered exponential sum tools. So a typical thing that you might want to care about is that you might start with something relatively simple, like a Clustermann sum. But then you might want to maybe either average over the A and B parameters with some weights, or average over the Q parameter, and hope to get some control on a more compound sum. Maybe it's an absolute value somewhere. And it's harder. So you have to use some non-trivial techniques to deal with things like this. If you're averaging over these sort of parameters, then the typical techniques you need are techniques from Dalin's proof of the Riemann hypothesis on over function fields. And this is what Zhang, for example, ends up using, and what we do in polymath. If you want to average over Q, that's a whole different kettle of fish. Then there's a whole different set of techniques using automorphic forms. I guess Philippe will talk about some of these things. So that actually we don't use in Zhang's work and follow-ups. It seems the automorphic techniques are deeper, but they have a weird restriction in that they tend to only work when this A is fixed. Like two or something. But for our application, you need A to vary or be very, very large. And then we can't seem to exploit any sort of averaging in Q by these automorphic methods. And instead, we have to exploit averaging in these sort of parameters, which are using more of the Dalin type methods. So I guess that's one of the main differences between Zhang's arguments and previous. So, before Zhang, there was lots of work, particularly by Fouvry, Bombieri, Friedland, and Vanijich, on getting equidistribution estimates for things like these sort of sums for quite high moduli. But they were usually powered, if I'm not mistaken, usually by automorphic type estimates, which involved averaging in exploiting a cancellation in Q. But as such, they were mostly restricted to bounded moduli A. And now the new thing is that by using Dalin instead of Clustermann, what is called Clustermania, right, type stuff, you can now also control variable A. Right. So these are sort of the general techniques, and then so the whole art is to somehow how to put these together. There's also one other technique which maybe I won't write down, which is just Fubini's theorem. You're always interchanging sums in sort of the shell game and always trying to tease out the cancellation. Maybe I won't say. So these are sort of the methods we have. It would be nice to have more methods, actually. These are great what we have, but they can't do everything. In particular, we can't prove square root cancellation. In almost anything with these sort of methods. You can prove some cancellation usually, but you can be the trivial bound by a little bit, but not by the amount that you want. So expanding F often is a bit lossy, and Cauchy-Schwarz often is a little bit lossy. We don't have very many methods that are not lossy, which is a bit of a problem, but we can do something. So these are the basic methods. So some examples of how they work. So the classical example is the Bombieri-Vinogradov theorem. Bombieri-Vinogradov theorem, the way it works is that let's call this a segment D. You look at the discrepancy of, for example, the prime counting of a Mankowitz function in some resident, in some, no, 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 no. Okay, that's this, and between x and 2x. You take these discrepancies, take the worst one, for each d, and then you sum over all d up to something. And the claim is that you beat the trivial bound. The trivial bound is x times log x to a power. You beat the trivial bound by any power of the logarithm as long as this theta is less than 1/2. Okay, so and you can do it slightly sharper than this, but this is one version of the Bombier-Vinogradov theorem. Okay, so this is one equidistant estimate up to level 1/2, and it's very general. You can replace von Mangle by any convolution basically of two functions with reasonable bounds, where each of these alphas is at most say logarithmic in size times maybe some power of a Dreiser function, and pretty much any of the interesting arithmetic functions we care about have this sort of size bound. Okay, so this particular generalization, by the way, is due to Murahashi. Okay, so how do you prove something like this? So you just have to use these ingredients, and it's just a matter of which ones you pick. So rather than actually prove this to you, I'll just tell you the ingredients that go into it, and then you actually have to work out that it works. But you have to check all the numerology. But the strategy is that you first decompose into multiplicative characters. Okay, and so if you you expand that into multiplicative characters, use the triangle inequality. The great thing about using the triangle inequality here is that it kills the supin A, because the A, when you do the multiplicative expansion, the A, when it comes into this coefficient, and then you take absolute values, it just goes away. So it's a very efficient way of killing the sup. Roughly speaking, you end up with something like this. Yeah. So So you can break this into character sums, and there's some normalization, which I maybe this, but okay. You bind like this. There's a technical reduction here, which is that these characters might not be principally primitive. Yeah. Okay. But okay. So you do some standard maneuvers to reduce to the primitive case. So let me just ignore that step. It's fairly standard. And then what you do is that you split this into you factor this into some convolution. For example, von Mangle can be split up as the Mobius function convolved the log function, for instance. And then you use this multiplicativity, which I'm sure I wrote down somewhere, but it's gone. This expression should split up. Oh, hang on. Before you do this, okay, there's some cases. It depends on where alpha and beta live. Okay, so you can chop things up by pigeonholing, give up a log or something, and you can assume that alpha lives in some range, say n to n, and beta lives in some range m to m. Okay, and n and m they basically need to multiply up to x, otherwise you don't get any contribution to the sum. Now there's some degenerate cases where alpha is very small or beta is very small. And in those cases, the bilinear sum is sort of degenerate, and you don't get enough cancellation there. So there's some cases in which alpha or beta is really, really small. So in fact, you don't do this. You don't do an IHES splitting of this expression. Otherwise, you might get some degenerate convolutions. You know, I mean, you can write any function as the convolution of the Dirac delta function itself, and this is a useless factorization. It doesn't tell you, give you any cancellation. You need a smarter cancellation structure than this, so that you have to split this up in such a way that the n and m are a bit bigger than this. You split up into expressions like this. If your character has a very small conductor, you can use multiplicative number theory, in particular the Siegel-Wolfowitz theorem, and you get very good bounds there. So you can assume the conductor is big, particularly you have many, many different characters now because you have a big conductor. And then what you do here is that you do something like Cauchy-Schwarz. You control this by an expression like this, and then a similar expression in the betas. And then you use the large sieve inequality, which I also believe I wrote down, but it seems to have gone as well. But there's a large sieve inequality which allows you to control expressions like this, like the square sum. And the key point is that as long as your characters have conductor less than x to the 1/2, any two characters will still be pretty much orthogonal to each other on the interval from x to 2x, because the product will still have conductor less than x. And so it's periodic or period much less than the width of your interval. And so you have enough orthogonality that you can get loss and loss of cancellation. And if you crunch through all the calculations, you eventually get the Bombeau-Vinogradov theorem you need. But because it relies very much on this orthogonality, the moment you go above x to 1/2, this whole argument completely breaks down. Okay, so that's the sort of the classical benchmark equidistribution result that we have that gets up to x to 1/2. And all the more recent ways to get improve equidistribution basically do something completely different. I mean, they still use the same box of tools. They don't use the multiplicative characters. They rely much more on additive Fourier expansion and Cauchy-Schwarz. Cauchy-Schwarz is still present. The way you prove a large Zipf inequality is ultimately Cauchy-Schwarz. I won't prove it here. Okay, so now what I'll talk about next is how you you decompose. So as I said, you have something like the von Mangold function, and you want to split it into pieces. So as I said, there is a standard splitting, which is you can split the Mobius function and the log function. This is L of n is log n. Okay. And then, of course, as I said, this is trivial. You can split any function trivially using the direct order function. So delta of n is 1 when n is 1 and 0 otherwise. And just to complete the picture, mu is also mu of the Mobius function, of course, inverts the identity. That's the Mobius inversion formula. This is the constant function 1. This splitting is not quite the splitting you actually want to use because it contains degenerate pieces. Both these functions can go all the way between 1 and x, and if this is too close to 1 or this is too close to 1, then you get a degenerate convolution with not enough cancellation to actually do anything. So you actually want to use splittings in which you have non-degenerate summations. You want to split up your von Mangold function into pieces, maybe convolutions of two pieces or maybe many pieces, which are somewhat non-degenerate. And there's two ways in which you can be non-degenerate. One way is you have a convolution where the terms are kind of balanced, that both of these terms are supported on fairly large numbers. Like maybe this guy's supported between n and 2m, this guy's supported between m and 2m, and so n times m equals 1, so it's equal to x, but maybe n is bigger than some x to some power. The typical thing might be say 2/5 or something. Okay, and m is bound above by the complementary, like 3/5. Okay, so one good term that would come out is some sort of convolution where both of these terms are of medium size. Okay, then you have a lot of cancellation. And if you're going into many pieces, maybe you just group them into two pieces, both of which are medium size. These you might call sort of type 2 sum. This is going to be really confusing. Let me not call them type 2 sums. Okay. That's one term that comes up. Another term that is good. Having a degenerate imbalance somewhere, one thing is small and one thing is big, is bad unless the big term is also very smooth. So if you have a convolution where this is supported on some very small n and some large m, then ordinarily this is bad. But if this function is very nice, like if it's a smooth function, so it's just some smooth function of m over m, and this is a nice smooth function. So it could be the constant function 1 truncated in some nice way, or maybe the log function is also a very smooth function truncated in some nice way. If you have a very smooth function here, this is also a very good term to have in your expansion, because if you do some of if you're trying to control something like this, you split it up into pieces. Okay. If this term is if this function is really smooth, often you can just stick it into your exponential sum, and you can just compute this thing really precisely, maybe by Poisson summation or something like that. So you can just control this term so well. If this was rough, then you can't do very much. You just have to use absolute values, and that kills the cancellation. But if this is smooth, then you have a good chance of understanding this sum, and often you can actually get a lot of mileage just out of taking absolute values, and you can really get good bounds. So these sort of terms are also pretty good. So you want to, so these are classically called type 1 sums, but I, for reasons which will become clear, I don't want to use that notation. So you want to split up the Lomachenko function into pieces which are either rough but balanced or imbalanced but smooth. These are the types of things that you want to do. And so this we have that we understand how to do. So one of the classical ways to do this, and so the cheapest ways, it's called Vaughan's identity, for example. And this already works for many applications. Although if you want the strongest results, often this is not quite good enough. The way this works is that you pick two thresholds u and v somewhere between x and 1. Typical values might be for x 1/3. It's very typical. And then you can split the Vaughan-Mangold function into a big piece and a small piece. This is lambda of n restricted to n being bigger than v, and lambda of n restricted to n being less than v. And actually, typically, since we work in x of 2x, these functions are the same, and this is just 0. And you also split up Mobius into two pieces. Okay, and Vaughan's identity, if you just take these three facts about lambda and delta and mu, and you just play with it a little bit, you'll find after this brief calculation that you can split for the Vaughan-Mangold function into a very strong these two expressions and then plus this expression. There's a certain amount of basic algebra that will let you split this into these three pieces. I won't do it here. It's not all that difficult, or actually all that illuminative, actually. If you believe this splitting, you see these terms are good. These are what are typically called type 1 terms. Because if u and v are small, this is a small convolved smooth, and this is small convolved smooth. Okay, so that's often a good term, and this term is the term of the other type. It's large convolved large. Okay, you have to group this one into one of these two terms, and so that's another term that you can play with. And these are what we call type 2 sums. And so this is already a very useful splitting. So one of the classical applications of this is to bound prime exponential sums like this. This is one splitting that you can use. It's not quite the most efficient splitting that is out there. Nowadays, we use other splittings if we want really sharp exponents and things. Let me first mention an inequality that we don't use. Decomposition we don't use, but we sort of morally use, which is Linux identity. Okay, so the easiest way to describe Linux identity is to temporarily introduce the zeta function. And if you do a Taylor expansion of log zeta around zeta equals 1, formally, the power series of log gives you this expression, at least on the level of formal power series. This is valid for s really close to infinity, for s really big. If you start with this identity and you equate coefficients, what you eventually find is that you can decompose the Vaughan-Mangold function into an infinite Sorry, there's an, this is owl. And then there's no one half here. Into an infinite series. So this is the log function, basically like one times log. Okay, this is a one convolve. Okay, so this is one minus delta. It's one except when n is one, in which case it's zero. Okay, so it's the large values of one. So this is L. This is roughly like the divisor function times L, in some sense. Then you've got this triple thing here. This is like the second divisor function times L, maybe over two or something, over three. And so on and so forth. Okay, yeah, so the divisor function is counting solutions to AB equals N. Second divisor function is counting solutions to ABC equals N, and so forth. Okay, so you have the splitting, and in principle, all these terms are really good. You know, so this is smooth. You call them two terms, either it's degenerate, in which case one guy is smooth, or one guy is smooth and one guy is small, or it's balanced. And this, in some sense, is the optimal decomposition. Morally, it reduces the study of equidistribution of Omango to the equidistribution of 1 and tau and tau 2 and tau 3 and so forth. Unfortunately, this series is infinite. Because of that, it's not convenient to actually use it directly. So we never actually use Linux identity directly. I don't know actual use of this identity, other than sort of conceptual.
It is actually finite sum because...
There's at most x terms or something, or log x terms. Right, they're log x terms, and typically, yeah, we can only control boundedly many of these terms. So as far as I know, there's no actual use of this inequality.
Oh, no, oh? That's a crime.
What? Okay.
1969-66 to one, Linux wrote a book when applied this to solve Linux problem.
Okay.
X squared plus y squared plus one is a crime. He implicitly between lines proved Bombieri Vinogrado theorem in the book.
Okay.
Using this and then.
Okay, well, I take that back then. I know the book, but I've never actually read past the first chapter. Yes. Okay, maybe I should actually read. Yeah. All right. So there are uses, but for the what we do, we don't actually use it.
Another question. You mentioned the lack of efficiency of one's identity. Do you are you referring to the fact that it wastes logs or do something?
No. Yeah. No. So for our applications, you can always waste logs because we're going to gain a huge power of log. Our objective is to gain huge power of log. Now
Can I interrupt? Because I will not cover the things at all. So that's an opportunity for me to say something. I mean, the number of terms he asked, you know, that really would be too much, but like log x, and that's a killer. I mean, because tau k of n of k is about log x, is huge. So what Linux did is just apply it for n almost primes.
Yes.
The number of terms is very small, and then in order to reduce to almost primes, you use fundamental lemma of C or whatever you call it. And it worked, you know. Right. Then his Brown make it much more practical and friendly application based on the same ideas.
That's a great point. Yes, that's what I'm gonna. Yeah, that's the next. Yeah, right.
Okay. You mean there was some sort of pre-sieving to get rid of the?
Right. Yeah. That's a good point. Yeah. So yeah, if you apply this. The length of this series is basically the number of prime factors of n. Yeah, so if you sieve out the small prime factors, then this is okay. Yeah, then I agree. This becomes a useful inequality. Identity. Sorry. Okay. Yeah. To answer Harald's question. So the inefficiency in Vaughan's identity is that for example, if you choose no matter what you choose with these u and v, you have to at some point study. You have to create terms which are imbalanced, imbalanced in the sense that the scale of this guy can be as low as x to the 1/3, and this guy can be as large as x to the 2/3. So the best convolution the best of type 2 sums that you can have are those where alpha and beta are both x to the 1/2. You don't want to move too far away from 1/2. It becomes the closer you get to degenerate, one, you know, so one control of x you can't do anything with. So the closer you get to degenerate, the less cancellation you get. And so you want to minimize the distance from 1/2. And it turns out that no matter how you structure Born's identity, you always have to deal with something. There's always at least one term, which is a distance 1/6 from balanced. And that's the limit of what you can do. But if you use Heath-Brown, which I'm going to cover later, then you can cut this down to 1/10, which is actually very important for Zhang's work. And you can cut it down further at the cost of adding some extra terms. So instead of just type 1 and type 2, there's now also something called type 3 sums. Except that Zhang's type 1 and type 2 is not the same as Born's type 1 and type 2. It's extremely confusing. Yeah, this is why I've not written down what's type 1 and what's type 2, because it's going to change very shortly. We should give more descriptive names. Like type 1 type 2 doesn't convey any information if you don't know it already.
I think people should say linear, bilinear, trilinear.
There you go. There you go. Okay, linear. Okay, that is actually a good. Type 1 sums are the linear sums.
If you understand something linear about the linear term, it's just that it's not bilinear, trilinear.
Right. Well, it's linear smooth.
It's a linear forms, linear forms, trilinear.
Okay. Well, more accurately, type 1 is linear forms with smooth coefficients. Type 2 is bilinear forms with rough coefficients. Type 3 is trilinear forms with smooth coefficients. Maybe type 1, type 2 is not such a bad name, actually. So the identity that everyone uses now, and in some sense, actually, it is optimal that it, with regard to this balance issue, you can't do much better than Heath-Brown identity, as it turns out. So it involves a certain parameter k, which you can pick. And it doesn't really matter what k is. As long as it's big enough, so k equals 10 is usually good enough for applications. So the way you prove this, let me derive it first and then state the identity. So you split the Mobius function into two pieces. So this piece is a small piece where you're less than, I think, 2x to the 1 over k, and this piece is the big piece. Okay, so when k is big, these are all very small factors, and these are the big factors. And the reason you do this is that you observe that. So the Bormangold function is the Mobius convolve L, which is Mobius convolve 1, convolve L, because this is the delta function, and you keep doing this, and you eventually. You can expand out mu into a huge convolution involving k terms of Mobius, k terms of 1, or k minus 1 terms of 1, and 1 term of the logarithm. So this is a big convolution, and it's not in good form right now, because there's all kinds of terms that are rough and imbalanced and so forth. But what you observe is that if all the mu's here were big, then this expression would actually just vanish identically on the interval that we care about, x to 2x. Because mu, the big part of mu is supported only on numbers bigger than 2x to the 1 over k. So if you convolve k times, it's only supported on numbers bigger than 2x. And convolving more will not change that. So this just vanishes. So this is 0. This is what we want. So now what you do is that you just rewrite this as mu minus the small guys. You stick this in, expand it out. You get one term that looks like this, and you get a lot of other terms. And so after a short calculation, you get Heath-Brown identity, which is that the Bormangold function actually splits into a linear combination of the small mu's convolve L, and then another linear combination of a few more. And so forth down to a lot of terms here. Okay, So you get a lot of terms, but only a finite number. You get about k terms. You get a first term, which is a lot like this L. Thank you. Right, but I now only have two boards.
How did that happen? Yeah, behind this one. At the bottom. No. At the
bottom. Ah, okay. Oh, I'm out. Okay. Where did Linux identity go? Did I erase it?
Yeah, you erased
it. Okay. Well, that was not done properly again. Okay. But this term was, so Linux identity started with like something like an L, something like a 1 convol of L, 1 convol of 1 convol of L, and so forth. And so this is a similar identity. There's some extra terms, but they're small. So at least initially, you almost don't notice them. They become more of a nuisance at the end. Basically, when you do this convolution, when you do this splitting, it's like Linux but with a bounded number of terms. And so the point is that you get lots of convolutions, but all the big terms are smooth, and so you have you're in really good shape of splitting into lots of good terms. So if you use this identity with k big enough, k bigger than 5, I think. In particular, what happens is that using this. He can split lambda into finite number of pieces. Of various types. So there's a certain combinatorial argument that I'll skip. These are terrible names, but these are the names that we're stuck with. You can split lambda into three types of pieces. One are the linear smooth sums, which I'm going to call type 0, even though they're usually called type 1. These are sums of the form lambda convolve psi, where psi is smooth and supported at a big scale, supported at some scale bigger than x to the 3/5, as it turns out. Okay, so you've got a small rough thing convolve a really smooth guy. So these are really good terms, as it turns out. And so like the first few terms to basically give you something like this. Then there's the bilinear sums. So these are things like alpha convolve beta, where alpha and beta are now rough, but they're supported between x to the 2/5 and x to the 3/5. Okay, so within 1/10 of the square root of x, as opposed to Vaughan's identity, which is only within 1/6. And then there's the type 3 terms, which look like convolutions of three smooth functions. And these guys are supported on n1, n2, n3, and this is supported on something. And n1, n2, n3 are reasonably big. Okay. As it turns out, the way I've set this up, they're between in the 2/5 and 3/5, maybe up to some logs or something. There's some other technical condition. I think they're between. One-fifth and two-fifths. And their products are bigger than n to the 3/5. Okay, so they're not too degenerate, but they're somewhat small. Okay, but there's three of them. Okay, it turns out through a certain routine, some elementary combinatorics, that if you split all these terms up into dyadic pieces, all the terms that you get will be of one of these three types. This fifth is optimal. If you want to get even narrower than 1/10, you can actually get within 1/14 of x 1/2, but then you have to introduce not just trilinear convolutions, but also type 4 and type 5 sums, in which you have convolution of 4, convolution of 5. But we don't understand the fourth and fifth divisor function at all. This is the limit of our current type of technology so far. So it turns out that using the Heath-bound identity, you can split up the Bowman group function into these three pieces, and then to prove equidistribution, actually by finitely many, it's like polylog. It's the number of pieces that you end up splitting into. But because we're going to gain a huge power of log, it doesn't matter that we lose some logs here. In the last lecture, I'll tell you how to prove equidistribution estimates on each of these individual sums, and then you just use triangle inequality, and this will give you equidistribution estimates on the Bowman group function. Okay.
Questions?
Wow, I really went over time.
Okay, so if not, we'll take you next.
Thank you.